How does it feel standing this close to greatness? Are you not mesmerized? Do you not have chills running up and down your pretty little spines? His program is the reflection of perfection. His weekly show gets all the attention. And when you're the greatest high school football coach in the state of Minnesota, they got a name for you. They don't call you a great coach. They call you Garrett Mueller. Play his music.
All I do is win, 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 no matter what. Got money on my mind, I can never get enough. And every time I step up in the building, everybody hands go up. And they stay there, and they say yeah, and they say there.
Hey, what's up, Tiger Nation, and welcome into Tuesdays with Mueller. This is episode number 41. I feel a little bit bad. 41 Jack is his Twitter name. We had to bring it up. Oh, then it's the episode. I'm Adam Peterson. Alongside me, the man, Coach Mueller. How you doing, buddy? Thanks for joining us so late at night.
Hey, No, hey, anything for this, right? It's one of the best parts of our week, couldn't not do it after the big section championship dub that we got on Friday and heading back to the state tournament. So excited to talk about it with you.
So pumped. I don't know. Do you, before we get to the game and everything, I'm kind of stealing, because usually I'd run this on Tiger Nation Beyond, but since I don't have the podcast anymore, I'm going to take 20 seconds of your show. Because do you remember, like, back maybe when we were growing up, I got to show you the upgrade I did in the room that I record in. Okay. So, like, you remember clap on, clap off?
Yep.
All right. Hey, watch this first. Yeah, I got. Right. Now watch. Watch this. Hold on. Pretty cool. Now, watch this now. Garrett Mueller.
Can you come do a free install at my place?
And it's there.
Good stuff.
After a section championship win, second year in a row, going back to state, coach, thank you. Right? Thank you.
It feels great. I told the guys, you know, again, we talked about, like, you know, doing the three-time, you know, district champ in a row and stuff like that, and how hard that is to do. And, you know, it's kind of the same thing to go back-to-back section champs in a really tough section, you know, beating an outstanding Lourdes team who, you know, probably would have won a couple other sections, you know, if they're in a different one. Just it's a tough thing to do. And, you know, there's only 8 schools that are still playing football in our class right now in the state. And we're just lucky to have the opportunity to earn another week back together. So I couldn't be more proud, you know, of the players. There you go. Players and the coaches, right? Everyone in that pick right there. I told them after the game, everyone, you know, played such a huge role in our W there on Friday night, big or small. So many guys that contributed to that victory. And so very proud of everyone. And like I said, excited to have another week to go earn another one.
Oh, so pumped, man. And what a game too. Incredible. Hopefully trying to you know, break this down as best I can. I was so excited to get to the game back in the Caston Manorville district. How much was it an advantage, first of all, just with the pregame and kind of going through it in the section semifinal in the same way?
Yeah, for sure. Ended up, yeah, being a blessing in disguise a little bit, moving the game from Schaefer Field to Caston for the semifinal game, and then being able to kind of rinse and repeat and be back at the same site for the section championship. Again, we talked about last week, just a familiar, you know, field and facility for us that we've played at a lot over the last decade or so since that field's been around. So to be able to kind of do that again, back-to-back weeks, you know, really did feel like a home field advantage a little bit for us, to be able to have the same pregame process in the locker room and in the gym, and kind of same sidelines and all that kind of stuff was huge. I think just for our comfort for our guys, and, you know, we'll get to the game and talk about a little bit, but a little nerves, you know, probably there a little bit starting off, and at least having some sense of familiarity there, I think helped at least with our pregame process to get ready for kickoff.
Oh man, we were so excited too, because the weather seemed to be a little bit better. Didn't get started off exactly. So Lourdes wins the toss. They choose to defer. We get the ball first. First offensive play, fumble. but then our defense responds. I'm not even going to start out with the first half. I'm going to try something new here, coach. If we can't talk about the first half without trying something new. So let me share my screen and get your thoughts on this. Share computer sound because I want to make sure that you can hear this.
Yeah.
All right. So there's, can you see it?
Yeah, I got
where. All right. Let's bring it up now. Here. Let's bring it up. Can you see this?
Yes. Nice. Look at this. All right. Oh. What a.
But here's the third down play. Third down and about 13 as they're going to drop back to pass. He's going to let this one fly. That's all. Oh, it's picked up by Tegan Malone. And he's got blockers out in front of him. He spins away. What a play by the Stewartville defense. We were tested early, coach. We had a turnover. And our defense came through the gold rush, picking it off and bringing it back.
Yeah. What?
That's just one.
That's
so
we'll
third just down and 10 one. Zellner under center. That's what I'm saying. We can't talk about
watch Max Peterson in the flex spot over here. We want to make sure he doesn't get a little counter. He's going to roll out, and there's Peterson in the flat, covered pretty well. Oh, Tegan Malone picks it up. That's his second one. He cuts it back in. He's trying to make something special happen. What a play. Oh, Glaze. It goes out of bounds, though. Tegan Malone, the savior of Stewartville defense tonight. That's his second interception. That one tipped off the hands. We called it. Peterson came out in the flat. He bobbled it a little bit. Tegan Malone, like basketball, he's got those beautiful hands, stole it out of his grasp and started running. Two interceptions in a quarter and 11 seconds, coach.
Yeah, just a great play.
Not done yet. Third and six at the 24. The press box announcer has the same trouble I do in knowing which side of the numbers.
This one's my favorite. On.
This is the best. This is the best one.
Though is where they're at. They'll have
this
to get
the best one.
Just about to the 30. This one's a pass. It's up in the air. Yeah. Tegan Malone, are you going to do it again? This guy is incredible. Yeah. Have you ever seen three interceptions in a half? Because we
much
have
time
now.
Is left in the second quarter.
Oh, that is amazing.
Tegan Malone, you're my hero.
Early.
On that one, he literally tipped it up in the air to himself and gave himself time to regroup and come down with it.
Had to get your take on that. Incredible. Now I need to get back and stop sharing my screen.
Well, and now that everyone was able to, see it and feel it.
Yeah.
I don't know if words even can do it justice, right? Like how big a play is that were? Yeah, obviously didn't have the start that we wanted. Mm-hmm. Ball kind of slipped out of Aiden's hand there in the first play, and they fell on it almost completely, flipped roles from the section or from the district championship game 2 weeks earlier where we forced a turnover, got the ball, deep in their territory. It was like, oh my God, like everything's getting flipped on its head. Fortunately, we got the Gold Rush defense to back us up out there and came out and just an outstanding job across the board. We were in, we have a couple different coverages that we use when we're playing defense against Lourdes to defend their option stuff. And basically our coverages dictate who has certain option responsibilities. And so in that case, Tegan did a great job making sure to do his job out there on the edge. It ended up being a pass play, and you can see him kind of drop and carry that number one receiver. But ultimately, he's responsible for the flats or pitch if it's an option play. And so his eyes get to the number two receiver coming out of the backfield there and falls off, knowing that his safety has, help over the top so that receiver running vertical is going to get picked up by the safety behind him, and he's able to drive on that second receiver coming into the flats, and the quarterback just never saw him coming, stepped in front of that thing and made a huge play. So it's it's stuff like that him and a lot of guys have been making big plays like that in big moments for us all year long. And we talked about these guys have played in a lot of championship games now, in their tenure, whether it was last year, in football and basketball, and now playing in a district championship game again this year and doing it again. So like the moment's not too big for any of these guys, and to go out and execute at a high level against a great team in a moment where we needed a play to get made. And it's just a guy doing his job. We talk about, we don't need guys to go out in there and hit home runs or do something out of the scheme or the context of what we're asking them to do play after play. He's just doing his job at a high level and puts him in a position then to make a play when the opportunity comes. So super proud of him. And all three of those picks were essentially him doing the same job, in all three of those cases. And, for some reason they kept testing him. I don't know why, but we'll take it.
It was awesome. I mean, and you look up the term disciplined response, you might see Tegan Malone, because we, like you said, we fumbled out of that very first snap, and it was a great defensive series. Alex Hayne had to be smiling from ear to ear, because I believe Blake Turner stopped something. Caleb Jansen on second down shot right through the line faster than anything I've ever seen. And then Malone picks it off. We go down and score two out of those three interceptions that Tegan Malone picked off for us. Two of them led to touchdowns. And like you said, reminiscent of the first game, first possession, the only thing that was different is when they turned it over, we scored. When we turned it over, our defense held strong, got us the ball back, we went down. But if you look at the first game, it was 22-0 at the end of the first half. I believe it was 20-0 at the end of this half, so very similar. Kind of going back and forth, big difference. Were you feeling okay You only threw the ball six times, coach.
I told the guys today, we just had our first meeting. And I was telling the coaches even after the game, I said, that's gotta be a record for me as an offensive coordinator, fewest passing plays called in a game. And, there's probably some fans out there that, weren't complaining maybe about some of the calls, but who could be, right? With the way that our big cats were playing up front, like you said. And I think, you know, that goes back to a lot of the conversations that we've had, about this team and how talented we are in so many different positions our offense, whether it be offensively or defensively, special teams, but just taking what, the defense is going to give us and exploiting the matchups, or the advantages that we can get, whether it be the run or the pass game. And, we had a hot hand with the offensive line and with Carter Miller, and, we had some new sets and formations that we put in, that we thought, would take advantage, from an alignment perspective on how Lourdes kind of structures their defense to defend us based on, you know, what we've played in the past and how they defended us, 2 weeks ago in that championship game. And, I told the guys today, that's not easy to do, not that we put in new plays, but some new formations and ways to get to plays that we like in our offense, with, just 1 week to prep for that, doing some new stuff from an assignment standpoint, outstanding execution across the board. And that's 11 guys executing at a high level play after play. That's not just one guy going making a play. It's not Carter just being a dude out there. That's everybody else doing their job at a really high level to be able to fit up, run scheme wise. It's for me as a play caller, when you have you can ask Aaron, the next time you talk to him, he'd say the same thing. It's like a work of art, when you have a perfectly executed run scheme in there with the offensive line and the lead blockers and everything kind of matching and fitting up the way it should. And that scene kind of coming open for the running back and creating an explosive play. It's fun to see. So very proud of all those guys up front. We give out our weekly awards, players of the week and all that kind of stuff. And, the offensive line got the offensive player of the week this week. Struggled a little bit, to run the ball against them the first time. I think we only had 60 some yards rushing and like 4 yards per carry is our worst of the year. And, so came into the game, that wasn't going to deter us and say, oh, we can only throw the ball against these guys. No, we kind of doubled down on the guys we knew that we had. And obviously given, it was a beautiful night for late October. But colder night and things like that. And just, it starts to make it a little bit more difficult to throw the ball with regularity, like we have all year long. So, and it's going to be the same thing kind of moving forward here next week as well. So, I think showed that when we need to run the ball, we can, and there was no secret about what we were doing with the sets that we were putting out there. It wasn't a pass set that we were, for a formation that we were running out of. It was a heavy, heavy run set and, challenged those guys and they answered the bell. So outstanding job by everybody.
Unbelievable. 34 carries, 262 yards. I can't do the math in my head, but it's over 8 yards a carry.
It was good, right?
It was incredible. We just completely dominated that fast of the game. You talked about our dude, Carter Miller, 17 carries, 174, 3 yards, 3 touchdowns. He must love Cassie Manderville because the week before he had like 140 all-purpose yards and 2 touchdowns or something like that.
Special weeks.
I mean, just incredible games. This is another thing that I thought about. We talked about the similarities between the Lourdes game in week eight and this one. How about the similarities between how important Aiden Helder's legs were against Cassie Manorville in last year's section championship, and also this year, 14 carries, 88 yards, two touchdowns, just keeping them off balance with the play action, and then him running the other way and just making something happen with those legs, just kind of sacrificing all the stuff that he's able to spin the ball. But like, to win this game, we need you to do this. He did it against Cassie Manorville last year, did it this year against Lourdes.
Yeah. And he, you know, and he's going to embrace whatever role he needs to play for the team to win. He's the ultimate competitor and he just wants to go win football games. And whether that means, you know, him having to pass for 250 or hand the ball off 35 times and run for 75, 80 himself, you know, he's going to do it. So, you get to cold weather and you have a quarterback like him who, can carry the ball a little bit. It creates some you know, mismatches for us versus the defense. Cause it's kind of almost like playing with 12 guys, right? Cause they have to honor him and his arm throwing the ball with how talented he is. But then when he can pull it down and run it, it's like getting an extra player, you know, in our run fits. So, you know, we had a lot of combination plays there where we had some screens and passes called, and Aiden has the option to throw it or pull it down and run it himself. And, you know, you could tell that Lourdes was, ready to take away some of those options in the pass game, and those linebackers were flying out to some of our wide receivers, and they just did a great job reading his keys on that and pulling the ball down. And we talked about the big cats up front doing a great job creating space for him. And when you get those linebackers running backward in the run game, you know, that's always going to be good for us. And so you saw him create some explosives that way, and really, really tough for a defense. Then, you know, it keeps them off balance with whether it's going to be a run or pass every time he snaps the ball. And, you know, probably something that we'll continue to lean on here moving forward.
Yeah, you're as special as your offense is, ended the game 34-7 was the final. Your defense, their ability to stop Lourdes option, I mean, it became non-existent. Their workhorse, they started going to the air, and Tegan Malone made them pay. 41 carries, 110 yards, less than 3 yards a carry for a team that is known for their running game. And it made me kind of laugh. I'm a big UFC fan, and they talk about John Jones as being one of the greatest heavyweight or light heavyweights of all time. And they say one of the reasons is because he seems to beat teams or beat guys where they're the best. He fights a kickboxer and he'll knock him out. He fights a guy that's jiu-jitsu, he'll submit him. You just went against a team that's known to run the ball. And not only do you hold them to 110 yards on 41 carries, you say, you know what? We're going to rack up 262 yards on the ground ourselves.
Yeah, there you
Incredible.
Go. Incredible. Right? Very proud. It was an impressive performance across the board. And that, you know, Alex does such a great job, along with the rest of that defensive staff, preparing those guys. We talk about assignment football and guys just doing their job. We talked about with Tegan, you know, he wasn't making any kind of, outside of the play on the ball itself, crazy plays outside of what he just does every single time. And the ball happened to come his way and made a play on it, you know, three separate times. But that was across the board. Everyone, you know, was doing that up front, with the run game. Did a great job just being gap sound. And that's the hard part that Lourdes offense presents versus maybe like a Kasson who runs like a double wing option attack. You know, Kasson in their I formation, they have the ability to run, you know, inside outside runs, out of that I formation in addition to the option stuff. So, and it's different how you defend one to the next. So like our DNs had to be ready for dive, to tackle dive if it was option, but they also had to be ready to take on a base block if that tight end tried to kick them out when they were trying to run ISO. And it's two very different things. And so those guys having to be ready with that technique and be really sound in their assignment play after play, not knowing what was going to come, is a really hard job to do. And so a huge credit to our defensive staff for getting our guys ready. And those guys, you know, we have really good players to go out and execute it just across the board at all three levels, you know, at the defensive line, linebackers, you know, in their run fits and option game. And then on the back end, obviously getting to pitch and things like that when they run an option. And, you know, in the pass game, they, you know, Lourdes, you talk about kind of being opposite of maybe what you're known for. They threw it like 17, 18 times, and they probably haven't done that all year long, or in quite a while, thrown the ball that many times. And I think that's credit to our defense taking away everything that they do well, forcing them to play left-handed a little bit and then do some things maybe that they're not as comfortable doing. And then we're able to create, you know, some turnovers off that kind of stuff. So, yeah, great job. Great job across the board.
How many people in that stadium do you think bet on Lourdes throwing the ball three times more than Stewartville?
Right. Right. No one. No, no one. Not me. No, not one. You. No, no one. Right. No. So,
but I'll take any whatever. That's what I like about you, coach. And you talked. You talked about this a couple of years ago. Not just play calling, but your team philosophy on where you guys are the best. Whatever position you can put your guys in to be the ability to succeed. That's how you're going to do it. It doesn't mean, hey, I'm going to just throw the ball all the time because that's what I want to do. You put guys in position. You have a great running back, like the days of Josh Burry and Jordan Johnson and Hamlin and, you know, Brandon Hoth. Let's run the ball a little bit. We got a wide receiver room with a quarterback that can spin it right now. But we also have right. Scanlon and Mueller. You know what I mean? Like, right, hey, this guys, game, yeah. We need to get these tools. And that's what I love is that you're taking what the defense gives you. Speaking of defense, again, our defense, I thought Caleb Jansen was fantastic. I know all that's a broken field. Record. That's like saying, hey, grass is green, sky is blue. Caleb Jansen was phenomenal. But the way he was shooting the A-gap and getting to people, yeah. like blowing plays up, Grayson Schneider, we saw him, the potential that everybody's talked about, 10, I believe he had 10 tackles. Lincoln Duby, he's a Lourdes killer right now. He was awesome in that Week 8 district championship. He had yep. 8 tackles again against the Eagles. So and then a guy, I think it's okay. I think it's safe to say now there was some concern that people were texting me about Henry Cheddar's availability for the game. I know that he might not have been 100%, maybe a little under the weather. Are you kidding? This guy goes out and has 8 tackles, 2 tackles for a loss. He had a couple big catches for us. Like, I appreciate him going out there. His 60% is better than most people's 110%. It just, but it comes back to your culture of playing for the guy next to you. You know, he probably wasn't at 100%, but he's probably like, hey, I'll give you guys whatever I got. Well, just really cool to see out there.
Yeah. And he wasn't going to miss that game, you know, for anything. You would have had to drag him off the field for anything else. So no, Hank stepped up and played great. And we knew he would find a way to go out there and compete because that's who he is. And to step up and have the game that he did on both sides of the ball, like you said, defensively, just outstanding all over the field. Offensively, had that big third down conversion on that opening drive after the pick. You know, Teagan gets that pick and we end up, I think we got one first down and then we had a 3rd and 10 and a big, you know, great ball by Aiden, and Henry makes a tough catch with the guy right on his back, right at the first down, extends that drive. And, you know, and then we end up finishing in the end zone and just kind of rolled from there. So I told them that was the first clip I showed today in offensive meetings was that third down catch, because I felt like offensively that was the play that kind of got us going. We had a couple other ones where we just, you know, were for whatever reason, you know, credit to Lourdes playing us tough, you know, and making us earn it. And I really felt like that was the play that kind of opened the floodgates for us and got us just like we could exhale and just like, yeah, okay, we're okay. And now we can go play. And so, yeah, he was great.
I called him on the podcast or on the broadcast for the game. And it's not his new nickname or anything, but you look at Parker Wongan and he's got, you know, the 16 touchdowns. Guy's been incredible. I called Henry Cheddar Mr. Reliable because it feels like every time that we need a catch for even 12 yards, you sit down at the sticks. Tough catches, he makes them, and that's what I love. He's coming through in big moments. But to your point, this senior class, I told Coach Meyer in the broadcast, it may be the most successful, when all is said and done, the most successful male senior class of all time, between what they did in basketball, what they've done in football. You got Parker Wyman and Caleb Jansen doing things in golf. Yep. I mean, like Carter Miller in baseball, track and field. I mean, just incredible, the collection of talent you put together. You win this game, you bring them together at the end. What's the message to them? I mean, I always love you going in there and celebrating. Just one time, I want to run in there and jump. And I guess there's nobody who cheer like they do for you, but.
Well, and I'm just, I feel lucky to get out of that mob and to say anything to them, because I feel like they get more and more, you know, aggressive with that thing as it goes on, which is, you know, fine. We all love it, but they just continue to impress you week after week. And you don't want to sound like a broken record necessarily either, especially, you know, at this time of the year, every game is a big game. And so you're always, you know, I always just talk about how proud I am of their, you know, commitment to our process and how we get to this point, right? It's not the fact that we're here, but how we got here. And then just thanking all the guys for the roles that they played in that process to get us that victory, big or small, whatever that is, because I want to make sure, you know, that everyone feels valued for that victory. You know, we talked about a handful of guys here tonight that made splash plays or impact plays on the field. And certainly that played a huge role in winning that football game. But then there's always, you know, there's so many unsung heroes during the game, during the week in preparation that lead to that moment. And so I always want to make sure that everyone feels appreciated from that standpoint. And then the last thing was just, you know, we earned another week together. And that's always our biggest thing is, you know, we love spending time together and football happens to be the thing that we love to do together, but ultimately it's the time spent together as a team. And you know, that's the message again, kind of going into this week. Let's go earn another week together. So
yeah, excited for the earning another opportunity. Earning another week together. You had to beat Red Wing twice this season. You had to beat Lake City twice this season. You had to beat Rochester Lourdes twice this season. Those are not easy things to do. Now you got another formidable foe looking, staring at you on Saturday. Somebody that we played in week one, 27-13 was the final score in that. But you and I both know the team that those both teams that played in week one are completely different from probably the teams you're going to see on Saturday. Waseca, coming in at 9-2, had a big overtime win over Fairmont, 21-13 in overtime. Laird Keaton had to pick six. Jose Mixteco had a 10-yard touchdown in overtime, and then they had that big stop on, I believe it was fourth down at the 1-yard line. They dropped him for a loss, ended up sealing that game. The Blue Jays upset Fairmont, who had already beat them 21-0 earlier in the season. They come back to upset them. Now they got their sights set on another potential revenge game. I'm excited because I think these are two fantastic teams. We can look at the bracket. Let's see if I can bring up this share screen again, because you did. I love your graphics that you put up. Can you see that?
Yeah.
Yeah. Look at this.
Pretty good. Got the state tournament there.
So you see Stewartville, Waseca, 7 p.m., Hastings High School, Saturday. Tell me about how excited you guys are. I mean,
well, you're right. Obviously, just right being in the game and being in, and having this opportunity to compete in the state tournament again after having been through it last year and then coming up short in the quarterfinal round to get back here now again and have another opportunity. You know, very excited for that. You know, Waseca is a extremely talented team. And for those that either watched the game or were at the game, know really how close that football game was all the way through. You know, we had the long touchdown to Scanlon that put us up two scores there late in the game, but really was a tight ball game back and forth. And you know, we certainly expect probably something similar. We'll take a blowout, but I don't know that that's in the cards necessarily. So we're gonna have to go earn it for sure. You know, they don't. Very similar to, I think, our team in that just not really any weak spots at any positions offensively or defensively. You know, their offense defensive lines are very good, big physical kids. A lot of guys that play, you know, on both sides there that are going to make it tough for us at the line of scrimmage. You know, they got as skilled athletes, you know, as we've seen, number three, number seven are, you know, as safeties and corners. Demarius Russell, I think is his name, is number three, is a very good player. And they, you know, they play wide receiver for them then on offense. So they present, you know, from a coverage standpoint, you know, where those guys are at. And then they run the ball, you know, really well. They got a young quarterback, you know, he was a first year starter back when we played him, but he's 11 games deep now and really a seasoned veteran at this point. And, similar to Aiden, does a lot in the QB run game. And so, you know, he's a guy that we have to account for both, you know, them throwing to, you know, the talented receivers that they have, but then him keeping the ball himself and running with it. So it'll be a tough task, you know, for sure. We're certainly excited and up for it and ready to prepare, but you know, they'll be a great team and be a great game on Saturday. So
yeah, sadly for Waseca, their top running back went down with a knee injury a few weeks ago. So we will see a little bit different offensive playmakers. I think one of the things that Coach Meyer and I talked about in the booth is this whole season, it's a journey, and you're you know, learning different stuff and you're experiencing different things. And I feel like sometimes the teams that we played against getting to this point also have a little bit of stake in potentially our success. And why I say that is because going up against a Lure team that has such a solid defensive line, like the Will Roth and the Weinschenk and the Wenzel and guys like Bookman, the guys like that, I feel like it prepared our big cats knowing Waseca's defensive line is also very top notch. So it's one of those iron sharpens iron. And that's why I have this appreciation for some of the teams that we've played and that have competed so hard against us, because I feel like it's also prepared our guys to go up against teams like Waseca, that their front line is going to be very similar in terms of against Lourdes, the motor, the skill set, the strength and stuff like that. So thoughts on that? Like, we're prepared.
Yeah. You get to this point now of the season, and it's going to be a tough matchup across the board at all levels, offensively, defensively, you know, you name it. So certainly, like you said, if you keep winning football games at this point, that's what you expect. But when you find ways to win, you know, then you draw back on, you know, those, you know, what went well, what you need to fix, and you use that then for the next one, to prepare yourself and to continue to improve. Like you said, you know, a lot of really, really talented teams that we went up against this year, and, you know, ultimately we're a better team now entering the state playoffs because of that competition that we had up to this point. So, proud of our guys for continuing to come back to work every day and focusing on that growth and that improvement. And, you know, hopefully we're in a position to get another W.
I hope so. Saturday. That's Saturday at Hastings High School, 7 p.m. You'll probably load the bus, what, Saturday morning, Saturday afternoon? Like,
Yeah. Working out the details still like? There. That. We'll probably get up there, you know, at a late afternoon and try to have as similar of a pregame routine as we can. We're creatures of habit a little bit. And we, as you know, we do things a little different in our program from preparation and everything else. So, you know, we like to try to keep that as routine as possible. So we're kind of in the works of getting those details ironed out. So the field, it's actually kind of cool. I've driven past it before in Hastings, and maybe some people are listening out there, and I don't know if you've seen it or not. So the field isn't actually at the high school. It's McNamara Stadium and Todd Field. It sits right in the middle of downtown, right off kind of the, I don't know, whatever the main drag is that you go, that you take through Hastings, and kind of a cool setting. It sits down a little bit, below the level of the road, and like kind of a semi bowl a little bit, and kind of a cool setting there, right downtown. So it should be an awesome atmosphere. We got the home side. You know, when you get to the state playoffs now, it's not seeded necessarily or anything like that with the matchup. So it's kind of predetermined who's the home versus who's the away. And so this week we'll be the home team. So it'll be great. So we'll have the home side behind us. And, I know our, you know, we travel as good or better than anybody. So we'll have a great crowd, and fans behind us supporting us there Saturday night up in Hastings.
Last year against Hutchinson, our side was completely packed. So I'm hoping that same thing happens. And I'm guessing the weather's going to be a little nicer than it was against Hutchinson.
So we're looking forward to that, right? Fingers crossed for that. That was brutal.
Is Hastings turf?
It is.
I'm assuming so.
It's turf field. Big kind of stands on both sides and big press box and scoreboard and all that. Good stuff. So should be a great
throw setting. That at me, big press box. I don't get to call the game.
Oh yeah. Well,
that's all right. You gave me 7 games this year. That was a real treat.
Happy to do it.
Incredible. We got to let this guy go. He has a big game to prepare for. It is this Saturday, Hastings, not the high school. Look for, what is it? McNamara Field. You said
McNamara.
I'm sure you'll send it out.
Todd Field, McNamara Stadium. I think it's got like a dual name thing, but, you'll be able to find it there, in Hastings, but I will send it out. We'll send it out here when we get all the spectator details finalized.
Look for the bright lights. Look for the bright lights. They follow this guy.
Team.
It's going to be incredible. I'm excited to get one more game to watch this team and hopefully more than that. But we got to let this guy go. The maestro that's put it all together four-time district champ, three in a row, and back-to-back section champ.
There you go.
This guy, right? Oh, there he is. When you're the greatest coach in the state of Minnesota, you're sitting right here in the picture.
Huh?
Best team, right? Say, lucky to have those. Lucky to have those guys and the coaches. It's a collective effort, but special group. And like I said, hoping to keep earning more weeks together and keep this thing rolling as long as we can.
Absolutely. Well, on behalf of Tiger Nation, thanks for taking us back to state. Sometimes I look at these kids that are going to these games. I was like, do you realize I went an entire high school career and never got to go to a state tournament to watch one of my teams play? And this guy just keeps putting them out in basketball and track. I mean, you guys are lucky. You are very fortunate to be around such a great collection. Success. Of athletes, great coaching staff, and great fan support. Just absolutely love it. We want to thank Coach Mueller for giving his time late here on a Monday night. We'll get this out tomorrow morning right away for Tuesdays with Mueller. We know it's everybody's favorite part of a Tuesday. Yeah, and I know it's the entire Tiger Nation's favorite part, at least. If they just could mute my side and listen to your side, it'd be way better. But everybody that's tuned in, that supported the team, hopefully you can come out Saturday, show your support, drive the hour and 5 minutes or whatever it is, pack the stands. Let's bring these boys the fan support that they deserve. They worked way too hard to get to this point. Going 11-0, not easy. And it's not by accident. It's by all the work that they put in, the coaching staff has put in. The least we could do is go up and stand behind them and watch them give us their best effort on that field. I cannot wait. I'm going to be there. I promise you that, unless a cop pulls me over and takes me in for being too excited. But anyway, we're going to let this guy go because big games need big coaches, and there's none bigger than this guy right here. For head coach Garrett Mueller, I'm Adam Peterson. Tune in next week for Tuesdays with Mueller. Take care, Tiger Nation.
Out here on the near side, tight end to the left. That's going to be an option. Oh, Caleb Jansen! Boy, did he come through that line fast. Shot the A-gap, I think, there, Coach.
Yeah, I'm not sure.
But here's the third down play. Third down in about 13 as they're going to drop back to pass. He's going to let this one fly. That's all. Oh, it's picked up by Deegan Malone, and he's got blockers out in front of him. He spins away. What a play by the Stewartville defense. We were tested early, Coach. We had a turnover, and our defense came through the gold rush, picking it off and bringing it back.
Cheddar and Malone.
Oh, he fakes the pass. Helder's going to run it. And that's a touchdown for Stewartville. Helder's arm has been fantastic all year. And he says, get on my back. We'll run this one in, guys. 6-0 Stewartville. 5:19 to go in the first quarter.
Once it goes back right, they're going to hand that one off the middle. Oh, great tackle there by Blake Turner as he came off the edge and laid a hit on a Ken Ballou. But I make option where he backs off of that. Boy, that's tough to defend. Lovely right up the middle. Caleb Jansen flies through there. Diving, wraps the legs up. Boy, is he playing fantastic from that middle linebacker spot tonight.
Yeah, he.
So we'll see. Third down and 10. Selner under center. Watch Max Peterson in the flex spot over here. We want to make sure he doesn't get a little counter. He's going to roll out. There's Peterson in the flat. Covered pretty well. Oh, Deegan Malone picks it up. That's his second one. He cuts it back in. He's trying to make something special happen. What a play. Oh, Glaze. It goes out of bounds, though. Deegan Malone, the savior of Stewartville defense tonight. That's his second interception. That one tipped off the hands. We called it. Peterson came out in the flat. He bobbled it a little bit. Deegan Malone, like basketball, he's got those beautiful hands. Stole it out of his grasp and started running. Two interceptions in a quarter and 11 seconds, Coach.
Yeah, just
something different was going on. We got three wide receivers to the left side. Carter Miller is next to Helder. Helder's going to throw this one. To launch that one right to Henry Cheddar, who sat down on the 40-yard line. Boy, Hank the Tank is Mr. Reliable out there. When you need a big catch, when you need somebody to sit down in that zone, number one is open. Resting also, Martashay Pearson. This one's going to be handed off. Stretch play to the left. Carter Miller's going to try to use that speed. He gets to the sideline, and we'll see if Selner can. He gets all the way in. Carter Miller. It's a touchdown for Stewartville on the back of two Teagan Malone interceptions. Stewartville has converted twice now on the ensuing drive, Coach.
There's
the snap. He's going to hand that one off right side. Boy, Rich Hatz at least slowed off. Nicky Ivers there sitting down. Oh, Blake Turner drives him backwards. Boy, the Tiger King is tough on tonight's field. Holy cats.
36 and 24. The press box announcer has the same trouble I do in knowing which side of the numbers we're on. 24-yard line. So is where they're at. They'll have to get just about to the 30. This one's a pass. It's up in the air. Take him home. Are you going to do it again? This guy is incredible. Have you ever seen three interceptions in a half? Because we have now.
Wow, that is amazing.
Tiga Malone, you're my hero. Zellner's going to drop back straight to pass this one. Boy, great coverage there. And there's Lincoln Doobie with the tackle down at the 15-yard line. Zellner, our defensive backs had a coverage sack there. 12. Stewartville has three wide on this side. Wong and all alone on the far side. They're going to fake that handoff. They're going to go to Wong and down the middle. I don't know if he got his hands underneath it. Did he? If he did, that's an incredible catch. They are calling it a catch. Wow! He almost had to slide like a baseball player, get his hands underneath it, and we are down to the 1 yard line just like that. Touchdown catch, as I'm guessing we're going to hand this one off. We do. Carter Miller up the middle, following that left side, and that's another touchdown for the speedster Carter Miller, and Stewartville goes up 19-0, 4:41 to go in the second quarter. Coach, just stick with what works. Follow the big cats up front.
Yeah, we got it.
Selner under center. He's going to fake that to Lovely. It's a reverse. Dino, though, read that. What a play by 19, Justice Dino. Oh, a little extracurricular after the play as Malone goes flying. I'm sure Lourdes upset with him after three interceptions. The defense has been one of the many bright spots for this Stewartville team. They've only allowed 4.9 points per game, yards per game, 138. They don't worry about that as much as what goes on the scoreboard, as Helder's going to hand that one off to Miller. And speaking of scoreboard, is Connor Miller going to put another six on? First play of the second half, and Connor Miller starts it off with a bang! From 55 yards away, the speedster gets his third touchdown, and Stewartville is on the board already in 9:45 to go in the third quarter. Let's go! They fake it, and he tries to go back the other way, and what a play there by Grayson Schneider!
Steps
to the right, Kim Ballou. I would imagine they're going to send him on some kind of route with his speed. Here goes Selner dropping back. Oh, big hit by Jamie Hart! And that's a turnover on downs for Stewartville as the big man, senior Jamie Hart, gets the sack, and it's Stewartville ball. What a play.
Well, we talked about winning one-on-one battles, and he just beat his blocker in front of him.
City was very impressive. And Selner's going to keep this one. He pitches it. Malone's coming in. Oh, he tried a little bit of a lawnmower pull there, Coach. You see that? He kind of, his right arm reached around. I mean, he doesn't have the guns that Caleb Jansen does, but Caleb Jansen also doesn't have three interceptions in one half.
That's true. That's true.
And that is official, the final, as the clock ticks down to zero. And surprise, surprise, the king is back. Stewartville, they made it a three-peat as district champions, and now they go back-to-back as section champions on their way to state after running off 11 straight wins. Coach Razzle has been telling everybody, send anybody you wish to play these Tigers, just don't send anybody you want back in one piece. And I've heard all the people out there, oh, Stewartville dropping 4A to 3A. Who have they really played this year? Well, first off, we don't decide which class we play in. The state does that. And people have forgot, Stewartville lined up against a top 10 3A team in Waseca week one. That Blue Jay team hadn't lost a season over 13 years. We won by 2 touchdowns. We played a top 10 4A team in Castle Manorville in week two, a team that's in the that was in the section championship tonight. We rolled them by 30, not to mention how allegedly other 4A schools didn't want to play us out of a little bit of fear. Two wins over a very solid Rochester Lure team. Absolutely hammered tonight. And all I have to say is that it doesn't matter to this crew who they play, where they play, or even when they play. You can probably call PJ Fleck and the Minnesota Golden Gophers. Tell them to set up goalposts in the middle of a cow pasture, because when our entrance music hits those speakers, the Stewartville Tigers are biting down on their mouth guards and head into the 50-yard line ready for a street fight. We'll run through a brick wall for the Coach Mueller and this fantastic coaching staff. I'm proud of what these guys accomplished this season, and if you can't tell, Coach Meyer, I am incredibly pumped that I get to watch one of the best football teams in school history take the field one more time. It's going to happen Saturday, November 11th, 7 p.m. in Hastings, Minnesota. We are still awaiting our home, either Fairmont or Waseca. They are in overtime right now, but this Stewartville Tiger team, 11-0, back-to-back section champs. Let's go.
Yeah, there we go.